Welcome to next session on circuit theory. Today we shall try to go through very simpler points in first module. As I have already stated that we will be adopting a sequence which is simpler to understand. So we will quickly go through Kirchhoff's laws. So I will explain the steps. In the last lecture we had got a concept of a voltage source. We discussed various things of ideal voltage source, impossibility to have such ideal voltage source, then the concept of a practical voltage source, the concept of an internal resistance which can't be removed from that source. Then we also discussed a special arrangement under which we can construct a regulated power supply which will behave like an ideal source in some constraints. So this might have answered your queries why in the examples which we have solved last year, the voltage source, even though ideal voltage source is not available, why it is shown in the example, in the problems asked, why the internal impedance resistance R is not mentioned in most of the problems. So a constant voltage, whenever we refer a constant voltage source, it clearly means that we are using an arrangement where you apply a power supply which is like an ideal voltage source, ideal constant voltage source, for reasonable current to be drawn. So that we follow very clearly. Ideal constant voltage source is not available. If you bring a dry cell, and put that in system, it would be a practical voltage source. There will be some internal resistance so that the voltage will drop down as current is drawn. Whereas in the problems which you have solved, you show something like this, fully knowing that this is an impossible thing to have. One can't have this because it is, say, 5 volts. This is something which we can't get. Still you have seen it in the problems asked. It means that we construct a regulated power supply known as the power supply on which we have worked in the laboratories, which is as good as ideal source within some limits. So till some value of current, it gives you a constant voltage, and after that it drops. So I hope this is clear. Then you will find that in the, if you go through syllabus, there are many other points. Especially there is a concept of current source, there are some other theorems and all that things. But I think that the sequence which I had planned in my mind is of different kind. So voltage source you are clear with. Using voltage source we will deal with problems. So in the first go we will only consider that there are two entities in the system, that is a voltage source and resistor. So we will try to solve various problems which consist of only voltage sources and resistors. There will be many more combinations which we can do using this. So at this point of time I am not considering either current source or inductor or capacitor to be part of the system. We are simply focusing on only voltage sources and resistors. Using voltage sources and resistors, we will be constructing enormous number of examples, and we will try to solve these problems by increasing the complexity of these examples. And when we increase complexity of these examples, you will find that the conventional methods of solving are somewhat inadequate, or in the sense that it makes the calculations much complicated. Can we have some simpler methods? Remember, all these things which are forming part of classical circuit theory have been developed centuries ago, where computing power, computing capacity, computing devices which are available to us as on today were not available. In today's context, one may say, what is the need? I will simply give everything to me. Just like in earlier days, there were many academicians, you may ask your parents, who were proud to have their own personal libraries at their home, in addition to libraries in the colleges and public libraries. But now, if this example is given to you, you will say, were they fools? Right now, when I simply have Google, I can ask anything to Google. So, to have a personal library today might not be so relevant as it was few decades back. Like that, the alternative techniques which have been developed means whenever there are some mathematical formulations and we solve problems, some simpler techniques have been developed centuries back. Those techniques were considered to be simpler techniques when the examples were to be solved manually. If example is to be solved by computer, wherein you simply give the problem and get the solution, there may not be much significant point for you to think which method is simpler. But I hope that these techniques are also useful in some other aspects, even in today's computational age, as to make computations faster. But whether now the thing is that you have so powerful computers and you simply use it for web surfing. So whether making computations faster really matters or not is a different point of view. Okay, let us now come to the point, is that you will solve various problems using only voltage sources and resistors. So, right now, only considering Ohm's law, which even though I have said Kirchhoff's laws, I will not be explaining Kirchhoff's law in its form, but I will try to present the thing in such a manner that you should be able to derive the expression for Kirchhoff's law. So, as of now, what we know is, we know an ideal voltage source which we use under constrained situation. We know Ohm's law. So, voltage source, it will keep voltage constant across it, and Ohm's law, where there is a linear proportion between voltage, linear relationship between voltage and current, so V equal to I into R, or I is equal to V upon R. So, using voltage source and resistance and Ohm's law, we try to solve the problem. So, solve the problems means the simple most problem can be, I think this can be a kg level problem as regards to engineering is concerned. So, 5 volts voltage source, 10 ohm resistance, and if a question is asked, calculate current I. Means I am taking these simpler problems and I will slowly increase the complexity. So, if the question is asked, compute the current I in the circuit, then you will say simply Ohm's law. So, voltage is 5 volts, resistance is 10 ohm. So, current would be simply 0.5 amperes or 500 milliamperes. So, this is most simple problem which we are dealing with. And now, I will go slowly to more complicated level problems, step by step. And when we go for that, we need to apply some common sense, some mathematical rules and all that. So, I am sure that everybody of you must be able to solve these problems. So we give value simpler, 5 volts, this will give us 10 volts, good looking numbers, 5 ohm as resistance, this is 10 ohm, this is 10 ohm, and the question is calculate I. So the question is calculate I. So this is some problem which is not what we can say any Einstein level issue, not rocket theory, but not as simple as the last problem. Is it clear now? So 5 volt, 10 volt, 2 voltage sources and 3 resistances. And how will you solve the problem? You can use any method. I'm sure that most of you would be able to solve it. So here I will introduce to you some kind of laws for node and mesh analysis called as Kirchhoff's laws. These are very simple, there is no need to specify them separately. Kirchhoff's node law says that at any junction point, incoming current is equal to outgoing currents, is what we can say simple working definition, whereas classical definition is algebraic sum of all currents at a node is zero. So when we say algebraic current, then current coming is taken as positive and current going is taken as negative. But I think that is not so required. So we work with simple definition. At any node, at any, what is node? Where multiple branches meet. So this is a node. At any node, incoming currents is equal to outgoing currents. Means at every node, currents come from various paths. From each path, some current will come. At each path, or at each path, some current will come or some current will go, incoming or outgoing. We may assume the values and we may get the answers. This is so Kirchhoff's node law, or it is also called as Kirchhoff's current law. That is, it's very simple. Incoming, sum of incoming currents is equal to sum of outgoing currents, or sum is also what to be required in definition. Incoming currents equal to outgoing currents is Kirchhoff's current law or Kirchhoff's node law. So then what do? At everywhere we give some values, we assume something, and using Kirchhoff's law we find the current in the other path. So this is to be found out, I. So you give, let this be I1. Let this be I1. So if it is I1, this is I, so what this would be? In Kirchhoff's law, you assume the direction of the current. You assume direction of the current, put some value, using equation solve everything, and if the answer of some current is negative, it means that the direction assumed by you is wrong or reverse. So if I1 comes out to be minus 3 ampere, means actual current will flow in this way. That's all. So you assume, so I'm explaining in very simple manner so that everybody understands, and slowly we will increase the complexity level. So you assume some current in every branch, you assume its value by variable and specify some direction. So I1, I is to be found out. So if this is I1, an incoming current, and this is outgoing current, this is out. So coming to the node, going away from the node. So I1 must be equal to this I plus something, or this would be equal to, what this would be equal to? Then there are two ways. You can assume one more thing. In constructing simultaneous equations of multiple variables, try to reduce number of variables. Or if you assume I2, then so let, we can have, then let this be I2. Then if you try to write the expression using I1 and I2 and I, then there would be multiple equations. So three simultaneous equations, three variables and it will take unnecessary time. So it is better that you assume I1, you assume I2, this is I, so this is to be found out. So you get rid of one of the variables instantly. So what is I2? By applying Kirchhoff's laws, by applying Kirchhoff's node law, simply current incoming is I1, currents outgoing are I2 plus I. So I you want to keep because you want to find out that. So I2 you don't want to keep. Let us get rid of I2 instantly. So I2 is equal to I1 minus I. So don't keep any trace of I2 in the system. So rub it out in it quickly and write this as I1 minus I. So what is this advantage we get? We get the advantage that only two variables are there in the system. I1 minus I. I1 minus I. So there are, using Kirchhoff's law, this to start with you need to write I2, but by common sense you can have this is I1 is coming, I goes here, so total coming is I1, going is I, so this must be I1 minus I, so that keep. So I2 also you, there is no need for you to assume, as you get some kind of practice you will be able to do it quickly. So using Kirchhoff's node law or Kirchhoff's current law, we are able to define the currents by using two variables. The two variables used are I and I1. So using I1 and I, we could define the currents in the system. So we want to calculate I. So there are two variables, so we need two equations. So for that purpose, we have to use the next Kirchhoff's law, that is called as Kirchhoff's voltage law or mesh law. Kirchhoff's node law is called as Kirchhoff's current law, or there is another method named as KCL. KCL, node law or current law. Similarly, KVL, mesh law or voltage law. So the classical definition of mesh law is algebraic sum of voltages in a loop, which must be a closed path. Algebraic sum of voltages in a loop is equal to zero. That is classical definition. Classical definition is something which is perfect but can't be understood so easily. So we go for working definition. What is working definition? Working definition is voltage source equal to voltage drop. Working definition is voltage source, that is battery potential, is equal to voltage across resistances in the loop. Kirchhoff's mesh law, I repeat, voltage source equal to voltage drop, or voltage across a battery, across a voltage source, is equal to voltage across resistances in the loop. So now how do we proceed? What is voltage across a resistance? Voltage across a resistance is given by Ohm's law. Voltage across a resistance is given by Ohm's law, that is voltage equal to resistance into current and drop in the direction of current. So what are the steps? I will write the steps. First, assume values of currents. And the direction. Second, what we do, using KCL, put values of currents in all parts. Using KCL, put values of currents in all parts. Then third, using KVL, prepare number of equations equal to number of unknown currents. So I hope the idea is very clear. Number one is assume value of currents and directions where in each path, using KCL, put values of currents in all paths. So you may say they may contradict, not contradicting. You may assume I1, you may assume I2, and then using KCL replace I2 by I1 minus I, so that by one there will be number of currents would be equal to number of branches, number of paths. By two you minimize the number of unknown currents. So this I2 was minimized to be equal to I1 minus I, so that at the end of step 2, you minimize the number of variables I1, I2, maybe I maybe without the variable without subscript itself is one variable I1, then or I1, I2, like that. So at the end of step 2, you ensure that number of variables, current variables, are as minimum as possible. You can't go below a limit. As minimum, I listen very carefully, as minimum as possible, so that number of simultaneous equations are less. Number of simultaneous equations are less. Then use KVL to prepare. What is KVL? Voltage source equal to voltage drop. And voltage source is battery voltage or voltage of power supply, voltage source voltage, and voltage drop is voltage across resistances. If multiple voltage sources come in a loop, what happens? We shall discuss later on, but not right now. Right now, let us try to be as simple as possible. Then in this case, how many equations are there? How many variables are there? Two, I1 and I. So you need to have two equations. So you need to go with two different loops and apply KVL. So you can have this as loop 1 and this as loop 2. You can also have this as a loop, but that would be somewhat difficult. So you use these two loops. So using these two loops, we solve the problem. So I think that it is very simple. I am trying my level best so that in the situation where face-to-face interaction is not there, no student should remain away from the understanding of content. So we are slow. We will go to complex level step-wise so that everybody is able to cope it up with. So now, first equation. Voltage source equal to voltage drop. Voltage source is only one voltage source. So on left hand side you write value of voltage source. Fine. Voltage source equal to voltage drop. Voltage drop is in the direction of current flow. So I1 is assumed in this direction. I is assumed in this direction. So this resistance is 5 ohm. So voltage drop across this is 5 I1. Voltage drop across this is 10 I. So 5 is equal to 5 I1 plus 10 I. So this is equation 1. I hope it is very simple. Then next equation is this loop. So 10 volt is equal to this 10 ohm, but the current assumed by us and shown is reverse. So drop would be minus 10 into I1 minus I. I hope I again repeat. So drop in current I1 minus I in this direction. So if we measure drop in this direction, we are in KVL, we are going in this direction. From this is voltage source, this is voltage drop. So in this direction, it will be minus 10 into I1 minus I, and this is as it is plus 10I. Plus 10I is equation 2. So now it is high school level problem. It is high school level problem where we have got two variables I1 and I and two equations, so that by solving the both equations simultaneously, one must get the result. By solving both equations simultaneously, one must get the result. So I can simplify the second equation as 10 is equal to minus 10 I1 plus 10 I. So it is minus 10 I1 plus 10 I. Oh, sorry, plus 20 I. Minus 10 I1 plus 20 I. Is, we can say, simple. So we can simplify it and say it as 2, or we can say 3, that is the material. So you can use equation 1 and equation 3 to solve. So I think it's high school level problem, we need not discuss, but since it is the first problem solving session, we explain. Multiply this by 2. Multiply this by 2. So 20 is equal to 10 I1 plus 20 I. This is equation 4. And then you want I, so get rid of I1. So add these two. 30 is equal to 40 I1. So 40 I. This is equation 5. And you get I is equal to 3 by 4. I is equal to 3 by 4. Now you got the answer. So is it over? No. If you are a casual student, then yes, okay, I have solved it. That is okay. But if you are a really studious, curious student, then you want to cross check whether the answer drawn, answer found is correct or not. So how will you cross check? You have found I, you will also find I1, put the values and check what happens. So what is I1 now? So if I is 3 by 4, if I is 3 by 4, then you can put value of I in one of the equations. You can put here and find what is I is 3 by 4. So you can put the value in this equation. That is, this is simple to, this is most simple equation which we can have. Oh, I think I made a mistake. I made a mistake here. I'm very sorry. Such mistakes do happen. When we multiply by 2, it's not 20. This equation you multiply, so it is 10. So the answer is 20. So value is half. So I1 is half. When I1 is half, if I put I1 value, sorry, I is half. If I put I value here, if I put I value here, what happens? So let us check whether I am correct or not. Let us re-verify. If you accidentally we got some very interesting figure. That you may get, yes, it's very nice problem. So when we put I1 equal to I equal to half in this equation, so what is I1? 5 is equal to 5 I1 plus 10 into I, that is 5, so I1 is 0. So am I correct now? So the answer is I is half, I1 is 0, then you just put these values in these equations and check whether we are correct or not. I give it 2 minutes, which you may think on your own and check whether the answers obtained, are correct or not. Coincidentally, we got the value of the problems which lead one variable to become 0. I1 equal to half, sorry, I equal to half. So answer is half. Problem, question asked was I equal to half, I1 equal to 0. So what this current must be? So this current 0, this current was I1 minus I. This current was I1 minus I in this direction. In this direction it was I1 minus I. I1 is 0, I is half. So in this direction I1 minus I will be minus half. So means current would be half in this direction. So this is the answer. So there would be, and you try to check whether all laws are satisfied. Half current, half ampere current in this direction, no current here, half ampere current in this direction. So if it is so, what, this is 10 volt. So 5 volt will drop, what this voltage would be? 5 volts. And obviously, this will be 10 volts, 10 ohm, half ampere, 5 volts. So 5, 10 volts, 5 volts drop, 5 volts voltage here, this 5 volt, so no current. So what we do? We find values, we assume values of current, using KCL, we try to minimize number of unknowns, using KVL, we apply KVL for those many loops equal to number of unknowns and solve the equation simultaneously, find value of the question asked, and then that is not enough. Find currents in all branches and verify ki tumhi shayad tela uttar kadhan tala gayacha. So yes, you just verify whether your answer is correct or not. So I think this is more than enough. We took one problem where one answer is zero, but that is not a, whether that answer is zero is not a something which is odd. We will take one more practice problem. In this practice problem, I will explain why we take practice problem. The practice problem, I will have values where you will find that I am finding it difficult, and in that case then we will go for why some methods of simplification are needed and how to simplify using that. So let us take one more problem. It is somewhat difficult, not very difficult. Again, we use two sources, but we increase number of resistances. We take 6 volts, just we take this as, maybe this is 10 volts. We make it as 40 ohms. Actually, to save space, we don't write units, or that may be one of the ways, but I think there is no need because you may unnecessarily get puzzled. So if unit is not written, it is a, by convention it is SI unit. So across a voltage source when I write 6, it means 6 volts. Across a resistance when I write 12, it is 12 ohms. If the unit is not SI unit, then I have to specify kilo ohms, milliamperes, like that. The question is, find current I in 5 ohm resistance. Find current I. I make a small change. There is actually no need of such specific change, but you will understand why I had made it later on. So the problem is 12 volt, 40 ohm, 20 ohm, 20, I make it somewhat more simple. I try to be simple as possible, so that the answers don't get, I don't get the complicated answers. I don't get complicated answers. So from that point of view, we have chosen the values very carefully. This I will keep as 8 volts. Or this I can be more easy, and this I keep as 10 ohms. So now calculate current I. So this is a problem where everything is told. There are 2 voltage sources and there are 5 resistances. A simple system which makes use of 2 resistances and 5 voltage sources, we want to find the answer. So what is the method? There is no new method required. You know only Ohm's law and you know Kirchhoff's laws. So using Ohm's law and Kirchhoff's law, actually Ohm's law is now you are so much what we can say tuned to it that you even forget Ohm's law. You just say that when to calculate voltage drop, you calculate it V equal to IR instantly. Similarly, Kirchhoff's laws are also so fundamental that it is so simple that you are breathing every instant. Are you aware that you are breathing every instant? No, because it is an inherent part of your life. Like that, Kirchhoff's laws and Ohm's laws should become, so that we should be able to quickly proceed further. So, how to start with? Start simply. Now, I use I1 so that without subscript you should not get problem. Sometimes it happens that if one is not having subscript, only I, then if you forget to give subscript somewhere, then the chance of error is there. So in problem I ask calculate I1. So is the question. So the question is calculate I1. So how do we start? This is I1. So you need to give names to others. So this is, you assume this to make it to I2. This is I2. So what this would be? What this would be? Don't give I3. I2, it is obvious. Now remember, once Ohm's law, Kirchhoff's law and concept of voltage source is known, finding current is high school level problem. At the most I will say high school scholarship level problem. We should not waste time in this. This is the last example I am taking where I would be trying to convince you about the complexity of finding answers. Remember, this complexity means when it was to be found by hand in few centuries back. In today's computer age, it is not a problem at all. So this would be I2, I1, so I2 minus I1. But now here, so I1 is asked to be found out. I2 I have assumed by applying KCL, by applying node law, by applying current at this node, this is I2 minus I1. Now here I am now helpless. I need to introduce one more variable. So what I will do, I will assume this to be I3. I will assume this to be I3. So in which direction I should assume? If I am wise, I will assume, I can assume any direction. But a person assuming in this direction, not fool, but person assuming in this direction is wise, will understand why. You can assume in any direction. If answer is negative, it is reverse direction. So that is I3. So this would be, so I1 goes this way, I3 goes this way. So this would be obviously I1 minus I3. This would be I1 minus I3. So now how will you solve the problem? Number of variables you can't reduce to 2. There would be 3 variables required. So I1, I2, I3. I1, I2, I3. So now you need 2 voltage loops. No, you need 3 loops. So you need to apply KVL for 3 loops so that you get 3 simultaneous equations and you get the answer. But then there are many methods with which you can go. Only thing is that it is somewhat tedious to get these answers. We will solve it so that everybody of you is comfortable with KCL, KVL, and then we will go for some alternative method which will simplify the problem. Which will simplify problem solving if ever we have to solve them manually. So in this case now, how you will apply loops? Now how many loops are there? How many loops are there in the system? There are many loops in the system. One loop, other loop, third loop, fourth loop, fifth. So there are 5 loops available. 5 loops are available. You can apply the loops in whatever way we want. This is also a loop where there is no voltage source. So when there is no voltage source is 0. So voltage drop should be 0. But I think we can apply in simple way. So what will apply? 12 volts, I2, this one. This is 1. Obviously this is the next. And this is the third. So we apply, I think there is no point in spending time. Just we shall finish it so that you will understand. So 12 volt is equal to 12 volt is equal to 20 I2 plus 12 volt is equal to 20 I2 plus 20 into bracket I2 minus I1. Why? Voltage is equal to voltage source equal to voltage drop, and as I am traveling from positive to negative voltage when there is single voltage source. For this, what we should do, we can discuss later on. For this loop, when there is single source, you travel from positive of voltage source to negative voltage source, and in that direction, if you are traveling in the current direction, drop is positive. If you are traveling the reverse condition, drop is negative. So 12 is equal to 20 I2 plus 20 into bracket I2 minus I1. Then you go for this loop. So for this loop, what we are having? 12 is equal to 20 I2 plus 10 I1 plus 20 into bracket I1 minus I3, because you are traveling in the same direction. 20 into bracket I1 minus I3. Now you go in this loop. So 6 is equal to minus 20 I3. Minus 20 I3. Why? Because you are traveling in this direction and current assumption is this. Current assumption is this. And this is same plus 20 into bracket I1 minus I3 plus 20 into bracket I1 minus I3. So there are 3 equations, 3 unknowns. It is a perfectly high school level problem, maybe 9th standard you can say. Equation 1, equation 2 and equation 3. Now how do we solve this problem? There are many methods with which we can solve. So what we do is we use method of substitution. So what we want, you want to find I1. you will find I1. So get rid of I3 as quickly as possible. Get rid of I3 as quickly as possible. So you can get I3 in terms of I1. So in this third equation, we use by substitution. So 6 is equal to minus 20 I3 plus 20 I1 minus 20 I3. So minus 20 I3 minus 20 I3, that is 40, minus 40 I3 will come on this side. So 40 I3 is equal to 20 I1 minus 6 on the other side. So this gives me I3 is equal to 20 I1 minus 6 upon 40, that is 10 I1 minus 3 upon 20. So I3 is equal to 10 I1 minus 3 upon 20. So what I do, I use this I3 here. I use this value of I3 in this equation so that I get two equations and two unknowns. I get two equations and two unknowns. So how do I do? 12 is equal to 20 I2 plus 10 I1 plus 20 into bracket, or I write again, I just expand the bracket, 20 I1 plus, oh sorry, minus, I write just below, minus 20 into bracket, 10 I1 minus 3 upon 20. I hope it is quite easy. It is just high school level problem. Don't complain that I am going too fast. So 12 is equal to 20 I2 plus 10 I1 plus 20 I1. So this 20 gets cancelled. So only minus, So minus 10 I1 plus 3. Minus 10 I1 plus 3. So the plus 10 minus 10 I1 goes out. So what I get finally is 12 is equal to 20 I2 plus 20 I1 plus 3, or 9 is equal to 20, I write anyway, 20 I2 plus 29. So we have got equation 1, and this I can say as equation 4. So I can solve now. I remove all the middle places. And take this equation on the top. Prior to that, I expand equation. I am just explaining everything so that nothing remains unexplained. So 12 is equal to 20 I2 plus 20 I2 minus 20 I1. So 12 is equal to 40 I2 minus 20 I1. I make simple. 6 is equal to 20 I2 minus 10 I1. You will understand why I made 20, because here I have 20 and this is converted equation, like I can say equation 5, and I have already had this equation. 9 is equal to 20 I2 plus 20 I1. Equation, I can say this is equation 4 and 5. So it's very simple now. What I can do, I multiply equation 5 by minus 1. So it is minus, minus and plus. And I add them. And when I add them, I get 3 is equal to, this gets cancelled, 0 plus 30 I1. So I1 is equal to 0.21. So that's what my answer is. I1 is equal to 0.1. I1 is equal to 0.1. That is the answer. Now, a lazy student will say, yes, I have solved the problem, my job is over. But a very smart student will say, no, my job is not yet over. I have to re-verify. I have to re-verify everything. And in that re-verification process, what will happen is, I need to calculate I2. What is I2 now? If I1 is 0.1, you can put I1 anywhere. If you put I1 here, in that case, 9 is equal to 20 I2 plus 20 into 0.1 is 2. 20 into 0.1 is 2. So 20 I2 is equal to 7. I2 is equal to 7/20. And what is I3? I3 is 10 I1 minus 3 upon 20. So 10 I1 is 1 minus 3 upon 20. So I3 is equal to 1 minus 3 minus 2 upon 20 minus 2 upon 20 means I3 is equal to minus 0.1. I3 is minus 0.1. I1 is 0.1 and I2 is 7/20. So 7/20 is what? How much? If you divide, it becomes 7/20 is 0.35. I2 is 0.35. So you verify for all possible values whether it matches. So I2 is 0.35. So I write each value and drop that. I2 is, so that there is no confusion, 0.35. I1 as 0.21. I3 as minus 0.1 means I hope you understand 0.1. I2 minus I1. I2 is 0.35, I1 is 0.1. So it is 0.25. And I1 minus I3. I1 is 0.1, I3 is minus 0.1. So it is minus minus, it is 0.2. Alright, right here in this place. So 0.35, 0.1, 0.25. So 0.35 coming, 0.1, 0.25 going, 0.35, 0.1,